All right, Mr. Nygren here. So this is War Leaders Clash of Nations. So I played this game back in 2009. It released in 2008. It's very similar to Medieval Total War Kingdoms. Unfortunately, it had a lot of issues with CTD or crash to desktop. It wasn't stable. But on my old gaming computer, I could play it fine. As long as I was prepared to start it up every now and then. Because during the campaign, I believe custom battles worked fine. But in the campaign, If you attack too many on the same turn, you risk having to redo everything, because you can't save the game between battles. You can save the game before you end the turn. So if you end the turn and then there is like 10 battles, then it might crash on the 5th or 7th battle, and then you have to replay all of them. So that's why you shouldn't attack too many factions the same turn. Because I tried to play it, and I'm happy to say now that it's pretty stable, but custom battles are 100% fine, and campaign was also very stable. I played over 7 battles in a row, but then on the 8th battle, I believe, out of maybe 11 or something, it did crash, or so I had to exit. So I can't, or should avoid, to attack too many in the same turn, because otherwise I risk having to replay everything. So what you need to do when you play the campaign is that you need to maybe only attack a few areas each turn, so you don't risk the CTD, because it might still CTD randomly on ending turns, but it won't CTD the next time when you restart it. So, but unlike Medieval 2, you can't save before the battle. You can only save before you end the turn. So you risk having to replay 7 battles if you have too many battles to fight when ending the turn. Okay, and of course we're gonna play the campaign, but we will check the details here. So we have HDR, high dynamic range, more realistic image, light quality, bloom, improves the general image quality, and aliasing, same as Medieval 2, I don't need to have it. I can't have it higher, okay. We don't need widescreen on. Textures. So we can have ultra high textures. I believe the capitals will crash. No, not crash. They will lag no matter what. Because they are packed with cities. That's why I made the LOD control the lowest possible. So, level of detail to control the quality of models in polygons according to their distance. So if I have this on max, I can have super quality on models at very far distances, while if I have it over here, they will have the lowest possible quality when you're far away. And that's good, because that made the capitals not lag when I have zoomed out view, but unfortunately it will lag when I am zoomed in. They are very detailed and packed. Okay, we have create infantry extras on. We'll be able to see drivers in their vehicles and commanders in their tanks. I think that's a cool feature. Destroyed vehicles remain, of course. Allows destroyed vehicles to remain on the battlefield. Yeah, I don't like when they randomly disappear. Like in Age of Empires or Battle of Middle-earth. Allow the corpses of dead soldiers to remain in the battlefield. So this is dead soldiers remain, and this is vehicles. I like both of them. And destruction pieces permits shrapnel to fly off objects that receive impacts or that are destroyed. Okay, yeah, I like all of them to be on. As for the texture quality, they could change it to ultra high. No problem. Then we have the trees detail on high, grass detail on high, ground holes detail, visibility of ground holes, okay, it's on high, and water quality on high. We could have it on ultra high, but it might, we could change that. Shadows, exteriors, visibility on the battlefield outside the game zone. Don't need that. Exterior objects, visibility of objects outside the game, so we don't need that either, because it might lag more in capitals, it's unnecessary. Same with the shadows, but appearance of shadows for all objects. It might be more laggy with shadows, but we could use shadows. Visual effects on high. Quality of visual effects in general. Shoot traces, activate shoot traces, vehicle traces, yeah. Like, yeah, when they move and such, yeah, I like that. Dust effects, activate dust effects of vehicles, motion, that's good. Visibility of environmental effects, okay. Camera, far plane, maximum distance of which the scene can be viewed in general. Maximum distance in which the objects can be viewed. Yeah, but I like it on low to reduce the lag in the capitals. As for the campaign, appearance of coastal wave effects, raw materials, visibility of raw material symbols over territories, that's good. Visibility of trees and shadows. Yeah. We will keep those on. I don't really know what the vertical sync is doing. Activate screen painting, vertical synchronization. I don't really know what it does. Maybe I do want widescreen after all. Okay, game setting. So we won't have armies creation on automation. So we won't have armies creation on automatic. Not building either. I like doing my own building and armies construction and creation. Technology research, we will also do that ourselves. Tax collection can be unautomated. Okay, fog of war. Fog will hide enemies' territories content. Yeah, that's fine. Use of oil. Vehicles need oil to move, that's fine. Use of raw materials. Raw materials are required to construct. Okay, I don't think I need that. Might be too hard. Use of regime affinity. Your territories will be affected by its population. Affinity, I don't like that. It will just lead to revolts. Use of morale. Morale will affect the effectiveness of troops in battle. Yeah, I like that. Trading of technology. It allows us to trade with other factions. There are only main factions. All the minor factions have the same boring units. They are represented with their own flags, but only the main factions can be played, and only the main factions have unique rosters of troops. Fast unit speed will be on, but we could have skip on fast unit movement when changing turns. Units move, yeah, we will skip that because otherwise it might crash during their turn. Let's check battle. Could have this on low, then it won't lag as much in capitals, but it's kind of boring to just see a few units. I prefer to play on large. I believe if I play on huge, it will actually lag. In my worst computer in 2009, I believe I could use huge and it wouldn't lag at all, but that's because back then I believe the graphics weren't as good, even when we had them on max. But with the better graphics of this computer, for some reason it lags when we have it on max. We will go for large unit size instead of huge. And we will use fuel, we use ammo, we will use morale, use of mines. Mines cannot be used if we deselect this, but I like that too. Weather will be always clear if we deselect this. But I don't want the weather to be always clear. Minimap rotation. We can move the minimap, that's good too. Alright, let's accept. So I tried to play this in... I believe I played a German campaign to the end in 2009, but I didn't record. I only recorded two episodes. They are still on my channel, probably re-uploaded in 2010. Then I played a Soviet Union campaign, and all the episodes there on my YouTube channel, an older channel, but it got removed. Okay, so I lost all those episodes. I didn't have any backups, but I didn't speak in any of those videos, because back in 2009 and 2010 you didn't speak, you only played and uploaded the videos that were 10 minutes 49 seconds each. So I basically just play the game as much as possible until I had no room left, and then I uploaded 11 minute videos. Then when I had uploaded all the material, I played more until I had no room left, and then I uploaded. But now I need to speak, because that's how Let's Plays are done these days, so it's more work. I need to speak and comment everything, and that's of course annoying to do for long periods of time. That's why I can't just play an endless amount of time and speak. I need to take pauses. That's why I also play different games too. But anyway, we are gonna play German campaign, single player, World War II. We have quick battle and custom battle too. It's like Medieval 2. The only difference is that you can only choose your own troops. You can't choose the enemy's troops. You can pick four factions. A custom battle, you can choose a battlefield including the settlement. You can choose the unit size, and if you want mines, morale, ammo, fuel, time of day, weather. And you can choose two game modes. Annihilation, it means that each side needs to kill off the other side, kill every unit to win, and kill the general is, then you just kill the general, because the general is represented by one guy. Okay, you can only have four factions instead of eight, like in Medieval 2. You can place the money here. You have two to four factions. Click here, you can choose anyone. But the bad thing is that they only allowed you to choose your own troops. If I pick, for example, Italy here, then I can choose Italy's troops. I can choose which faction I want to fight as against or together with. If I place them in the same team, they will be allied. Okay. And then I can choose a general, or I can and promote him so he becomes very good. Or I can skip that and just add ordinary troops. We have infantry, we have tanks, we have anti-tanks, we have anti-aircraft, aircraft, transport, artillery, reconnaissance, and the general. Okay, so we can add troops. We don't need a general. Okay, I clicked the wrong button there. Anyway, we can choose Italy's troops, and that's the faction we are playing, but we cannot choose our allies' troops or our enemy's troops. And when we click start after we have chosen our army, then the enemy and the ally will be chosen by the AI, and that's a really bad thing, I think, that I didn't like in this game. A quick battle is just like in Medieval 2. Then we had the multiplayer campaign in this, but unfortunately there were no TCP/IP LAN. Instead it used GameSpy, just like Medieval 2. The difference is that Medieval 2 and Rome Total War, they had the option to play LAN through TCP/IP as well, while this game only had GameSpy, and GameSpy went bankrupt or something. And that's why their servers were taken down, so now you can't play multiplayer anymore. But one thing I thought was cool with this game was that it had a multiplayer campaign. You can play, if you had two GameSpy users, then you could play with a friend in the campaign. While Medieval 2 and Rome Total War only allowed hot seat campaigns in the campaign, where you share the screen, but they didn't allow you to play from different computers. But I tried it, I believe, in 2011 between both of my stational computers and the laptop, and I believe that real-time battles didn't work, if I'm not wrong. I think only auto-resolves were possible, so in other words, it ended up being about the same as hot seat. So I was disappointed, but now I can't even play that because GameSpy disappeared. Okay, so in 2018 in January I uploaded two episodes with Germany, but the game would crash each time after I won a battle. I couldn't win a battle, it would crash immediately upon returning to the map, either on the loading screen or a few minutes after returning to the map, so I had to give up and uninstall the game. But now it worked. I played for many turns and and I could play battles. It can still crash when ending turns, when starting battles. It's when I start a battle, sometimes the startup screen, it's a white screen, and then your army shows up, and sometimes it will lock itself on the white screen and you won't get to the army. So anyway, so the faction in the game that you can play as, so you are playing as the faction leaders. The game is named War Leaders Clash of Nations because you are controlling the faction, but you are also controlling the leader. If the leader is captured, if he is captured in a region, then you lose the game. So the enemy doesn't need to take all your areas, they just need to kill, for example, Hitler to win. Okay, so you have two goals. One, conquer the other factions, and two, keep your leader alive, otherwise you lose. If he is captured, that means he is killed, then you lose the game. So you have Germany, Adolf Hitler, you have Hideki Tojo, Japan. Hideki Tojo was the prime minister in Japan, executed after the war, blamed for the war crimes. He was the leader of the military, but he isn't the emperor. The emperor was named Hirohito. I said that in the other video too. So Hirohito survived until the 1980s and wasn't really blamed for the war, even though I believe the emperor had some real power back then. It's just that he was seen as a living god, and instead Hideki Tojo was the one who got the blame after the war. Okay, we have Benito Mussolini, Italy. We have Franklin D. Roosevelt, USA, United States of America. We have Winston Churchill of the United Kingdom, the British Commonwealth of Nations, also known as the British Empire. We have Joseph Stalin and the USSR, United Soviet Socialist Republics, also known as the Soviet Union. We have Charles de Gaulle, France. He wasn't really the leader in 1939. He was the leader of the Free French after they lost to Germany. But in this game, he is the leader from the start. But their real leader was just some ordinary politician, I believe. Also, Pétain, a war hero from the First World War, he took over after France had lost to Germany. But this game started in 1939, so it's before France has lost, but it's still led by the most known guy in this game. They choose de Gaulle because he is known as the champion of the French. He became president after the war. Okay, so Germany. Son of a customs agent, Hitler was born near Linz, Austria on April 20, 1989. A brilliant pupil at primary school, he did not complete his secondary education, left school at the age of 16. He subsequently developed a fruitless interest in painting and architecture. At that time, his antisemitism was awoken and continued to develop a favorable atmosphere. In 1939, he moved to Munich, Germany, thereby evading military service with the Austro-Hungarian army, which he saw as led by Jews and Hungarians, and in the hope of finding new opportunities. In 1914, at the beginning of the First World War, he enlisted as a volunteer in the German army, serving in France and Belgium. He was awarded the Iron Cross, both first and second class, fell wounded and was promoted to corporal. Serving in the war became a fundamental life experience for Hitler, and Germany's capitulation in 1918 impacted heavily on him and caused him great irritation. This ultimately led him to subscribe to the conservative myth, stab in the back. Okay. He maintained links with the army for some time, spying on leftist activity within the ranks until his incorporation into extreme right-wing circles in Munich, consisting mainly of ex-combatants. In 1921, creation of the Nazi Party was formalized, and in 1923 he organized an attempted coup known as the Bierhall Putsch, which ended in failure and Hitler's incarceration. During his imprisonment, he wrote Mein Kampf in an attempt to malice his thoughts. In 1924, Hitler became the undisputed leader of the Nazi movement. In 1929, the economic depression and discontent with the Treaty of Versailles instigated the formation of the Nazi Party. Following defeat in the 1932 elections, Hitler initiated a campaign of disturbances which eventually forced von Hindenburg to ask him to become the German Chancellor in coalition with other parties. He obtained victory in the 1933 elections and assumed the leadership of the state in 1934, whence he proceeded to neutralize all internal and external opposition to the Nazi Party, by then the only legal political party. The rearmament of Germany began in 1935. Compulsory military service was reintroduced and territorial claims began, aimed at overcoming the humiliation suffered in 1918. As a result, Rhineland and the Sudets were reoccupied and Austria annexed. In March 1939, the Czechoslovakian state was dismantled, with a German protectorate over Czech and an allied interim government in Slovakia. This time, 1939, Hitler was still not renounced all his territorial demands. At this time, 1939, Hitler has still not renounced all his territorial demands. Best unit, Panzer IV Tiger. Strengths, armored vehicles, panzers and submarines, Wolfpack. Weaknesses, few territories and initial resources. Okay, and here's the location on the map. So Germany is pretty small compared to the Soviet Union and US and others. Britain is also vast. You can see Japan, there's Manchuria, that's why they are pretty big. Italy has areas in Africa, so they are also pretty big. And of course US is mainland US, they have Alaska, and then they have a few areas down here like the Philippines. The United Kingdom, the British Empire, they have Australia, they have New Zealand, they have India, Africa, and other areas in the Middle East, they have Canada, so they are really huge, and then of course Soviet Union, really big too, and France has a lot of areas in Africa, they have this area too, and they have Indochina. And the best unit of the French, RL-44, best unit of the Soviet Union, T-34-76A, a tank, best unit of the UK is paratroopers, best unit of the United States is the B-29 Superfortress bomber plane, and Italy has the Decima mass commandos, that's their best unit, and Japan has the Mitsubishi A6M20 fighter. It was the best fighter in the world in 1939 or 1940, but the US managed to get hold of one of them, and then they could create a plane that was better than the Zero in every way. But it was the best when they started the war, and then a few years later it wasn't the best anymore. Okay, and Germany had the Tiger. Okay, Panzer 6 Tiger. I might have said 4 before. Okay, and the story. After her defeat in the Great War, Germany was seeking a new identity and place in the post-Great War European scene after the rise and fall of Kaiser Wilhelm II. Following the Kaiser's desertion, elections were held to establish a constituted assembly, which agreed the foundation of German Democratic Republic, known as the Weimar Republic. The newly established regime had to resist coups such as the Putsch of 1920 and 1923, led by military figures and members of Adolf Hitler's Nationalist Party. Meanwhile, in 1919, Communist Party of Germany's Germany's fight for a proletariat revolution similar to that which took place in Russia was aborted. I see. The government, consisting mainly of social democrats, was distinguished by its moderation with a jealous respect for private property and without rancor towards the civil servants of the previous regime. In terms of foreign policy, territorial losses and sanctions incumbent in the new frontier plans were not acceptable for the nation, naming them diktat. French occupation of Ruhr in the face of non-payment of reparations was met by strikes in Germany and passive resistance by the population. After a severe increase in inflation in 1923, the economy was able to recover and the Dawes plan was put in action to pay off incurred debts. The ultranationalist movement strengthened since the end of the Great War, became even more influential during the crisis of 1929. They were composed of war veterans and extreme right-wing groups and defended a program of nationalist regeneration. Such groups also presented demands on territories lost in the Treaty of Versailles, with a wider aim of creating vital space for the German nation. The main spokesperson for this movement is Adolf Hitler, as his party's leader. After suffering defeat in the 1930 elections, Hitler is named German Chancellor in 1933. Later succeeding Hindenburg as head of state or president. Von Hindenburg had the title of president. The arrival of Hitler to power has instigated the militarization of Rhineland, large-scale rearmament and compulsory military service with a view to reclaiming territories he believes should be an integral part of the German nation. Let's click next. Okay. So we could use an advisor. We can have difficulty on war leader, the hardest difficulty. We will high historical accuracy level on. So if I have low, that means it's a sandbox campaign. You can do anything you want. There are no alliances from the start. Anyone can ally anyone can fight anyone. But in the end, you will have to fight everyone because they will declare war on you when you get too strong. Medium, then you start historical accurate with your allies Japan and Italy if you are Germany, and with allies if you are an allied faction, and then you can change your alliances, you can betray your allies, and you can do whatever you want, and in the end you will have to fight everyone because they will all betray you in the end. And high historical accuracy is you stay allied with your historical accurate friends in the war and then fight the others. And they can't betray you, and you can't betray them. And you can't ally the allies if you are an Axis power, or vice versa. Okay, and I think we will go for high. Fog of war could be on. Use of oil could be on. I don't really need raw materials. I think it could be too hard. Regime affinity, I don't need that either. Use of morale. Trading of technology, yeah, that could be on. Tax flaking could be automated. And I think we're done. We want to have the numbers at large. I don't know if we want huge. It might lag. We will do. I'm not sure. I played a custom battle on huge and both armies were fully sized, and I believe it lagged slightly. I think we will go for large. Okay, let's start the game. And also, I don't like the start of the game, that they do not have any armies. We will use some sheets to get all the structures that they had historically from the start, just like I did in 1942, and then we'll get some starting troops. September 1st, 1939.
by conflict. The rest of the world looks on with concern over the possible spread of fighting throughout the continent and the looming threat of war scorching the world like a gunpowder trail.
All right. We have 5,000 in money. We'll need to add a few more because we want all the starting structures in every area. We have 685 in oil too. Okay, this advisor is in the upper left corner, just like in Medieval 2. The world minimap is a globe, very fitting, just like Hitler had a globe in his office in the right chancellery. Okay, and we can zoom out, so the planet will be a globe too. Zoom in. It's the entire world. They were lazy with all the minor factions. Okay, they don't have unique rosters. So the advisor says, should I remember you that the buttons on the right side of the mini-world globe allows you to change the information filter active for the territories. You can also use the control key or the number keys 1 to 11 to activate the various filters. Okay. Yeah, we can control speed there. We can also click on this to speed forward to that location on the real world map, just like in Medieval 2. This a world map here. So we have some menus. Here we have the Ministry of Economy and Trading. You can see all the details of the treasury. So your tax is 2,787. Available credit 5,000. Average tax rate 60%. We can change it here. Automation of tax collection should be on. And you can see details like building maintenance 500, armies maintenance 2,397, total expense 2,897, total income 2,787. So we have a little more expense than income. That's not good. Initial cash flow, we risk going bankrupt. Initial cash flow, financial balance minus 110. We are minus 110 each turn. Cash flow forecast 4,890. Then we have raw materials, oil reserves 685, production 35, consume 0, oil balance 35, oil consume forecast turn 685. Raw materials. So these are the raw materials, but we decided to not play with raw materials because I probably suck with it anyway. Then we will just not be able to recruit anything and it will be boring. Okay, let's move the ships. In this game we just move them like this by clicking on the ships and then clicking on the like area where we want to move them. It's more like Axis and Allies when it comes to movement on the map. Okay, we started with some troops, but far from the correct number in 1939. We should be strong enough to invade in 1939 and should have enough to be able to protect all the areas. Germany was ready for war by that time. So, we can check the other areas first. We have a technology area. We can upgrade technology here. We won't use any sheets there. We will play like it's supposed to, even though in real history probably Germany and Hitler probably already had a lot of this stuff ready when they started the war. But we will play correctly, so we will just start with this one. It's a, let's see here, camouflage clothing. The need to avoid the detection by the enemy became obvious during the positional fighting and finally deeply penetrative assaults of the First World War. Under these circumstances, the armed forces abandoned the use of brightly colored uniforms for more moderate coloring. Camouflaging became necessary. this time the textile industry has the capacity to produce and distribute mythic garments that will aid our soldiers in action, necessary for training commanders and snipers. By the way, the voices in battle in this game are really, really annoying to hear. They sound really unserious, very childish. I have silenced the voices, so you won't have to be bothered by them. Plus, all the factions had the same English voices. Okay. So no voices this time. If we double click on the territory, we get to this screen. Here we can see details, the area, population 2490, regime affinity 50, but we didn't play with it, so we won't have revolts. And we can see the buildings that we have constructed already. We have barracks for regular troops, and we have a port, and we have a shipyard. This place, we can construct some stuff too and recruit some troops. Okay, so here we have a cannon factory and a light vehicle factory, airfield, network of coastal guns, intelligence headquarters building, and a center for military research. I don't trust this game to be stable forever. I mean, it will probably crash every now and then, and I believe also in 2009 that I couldn't move past a certain point when I tried to play it as it was intended, so that's why we need to have a quicker, faster start than intended. So when I click on Alt and B, we will auto-recruit everything, but I need to click on the X after clicking Alt B. Then I return, and we have built all those buildings. And we have all of these. I won't build the rest. We can now get the medium vehicle factory and an aircraft factory, but that's not something I want now. So we got the buildings I just previewed. That means we can recruit some units now. We'll get one of each of these, including an agent. We can also get tanks now, we couldn't before. So we have the Wehrmacht infantry. The infantry is the army's basic weapon. Every soldier receives or should receive basic infantry training. Their main tasks are the defense of positions, attacks on enemy lines, and the occupation of territory. Infantry are vulnerable to artillery, mortar, and machine gun fire, as well as tanks and enemy aircraft. Yeah, they are really basic. We can place them in buildings and in bunkers in this game, so it's pretty cool. And they can lay down, they can run, and they can sit, etc. There are a lot of cool options with them. So that's the Wehrmacht infantry. Then we have the pioneers. The engineering corps is one of the basic elements of the land forces. Engineers form sapper and transmission units. Their duties, among others, are the laying and clearing of minefields and the repairing of vehicles. The training takes place in the barracks for regular troops. Okay. Then we have the medics. GE, or German paramedic. Medical soldiers or officers are charged with aiding those wounded in combat. They will accompany our troops, providing first aid and ensuring the satisfactory recovery of all infantry units. They can become targets for snipers, as they are easily distinguished by the Red Cross emblem on their uniform. They are chosen from the new recruits and officers with medical knowledge and trained in the barracks for regular troops. Then we have the German machine gunner, MG gunner, machine gun gunner. The machine gun has been a basic infantry weapon since the Great War. This weapon's firing cadence endows it with great power and ability to form the basis of the defense of a troop, section, or company of infantry. The soldiers charged with handling machine guns are trained with regular troops and not as an elite force. Okay. Then we have the German mortar gunner. Mortars reach an important status in war due to their aptness for attacking enemy trenches over short distances. Thanks to their curved firing trajectory, this light, portable weapon provides support to the infantry in both defense and attack. If well placed, preferably in an elevated position, the mortar is very effective against infantry in the open field and for bombarding entrenched positions. Yeah, it's a cool unit. Then we have the agent, German spy. Secret agents which have infiltrated enemy territory carry out one of the most dangerous yet necessary missions in order to aid strategic planning. The agents, who may be of civil or military background, undergo intense training in encryption techniques, subterfuge, languages and weaponry. Their missions are extremely diverse and include information gathering, technology stealing, elimination of targets, sabotage, counter-espionage, and protection. If they fail on a mission and are captured, they will be executed for spying. Okay, they are pretty much all the agents of Medieval 2 in one, with the exception of the diplomat, because we do not have diplomats in this game. Instead, there is a diplomat menu between the leaders. Okay, so we can get tanks here. We have only the first two. We have the Panzer 1 OSF-B. It's worse than the worst tank of Total War 1942. Okay. The tank debuted in 1916 during the Great War. Its first mission was to break static battle fronts, allowing the infantry to advance through the breach. Following the end of the conflict, important theoretical studies were carried out, which discussed what the tank's role should be and whether it could act as an independent weapon. The tank must combine three elements: mobility, armory, and weaponry. The combination of these elements permits mobile combat with great firepower and protection against incoming enemy fire of any nature. The tank is one of the most versatile of units and is greatly effective against any type of enemy vehicle or infantry. Tanks are, however, more vulnerable in enclosed spaces, especially in cities when confronted by enemy infantry and, of course, against anti-tank weapons. Okay, and the other one, the Panzer II OSF-F. This is the one that is in Total War 1942, the worst one. Same text here. No new text. Okay, but we can see that the cannon is different. It's one slightly bigger cannon compared to this one, having two smaller. I believe these are two machine guns, so the tank is just firing a machine gun from two turrets. Well, this one has an actual tank turret, but a very small one. It won't do much damage to a good modern tank of the war. Okay, then we have this. I believe we are. Check this. This 7.5 centimeter pack 40 artillery. Anti-tank, it's an anti-tank artillery. Anti-tank artillery must undergo constant renewal in order to keep a pace with the continuous developments in enemy tank armory and weaponry. They are vulnerable as they reveal their position when fired. It can surprise the enemy if well camouflaged. These cannons are also effective against terrestrial targets and can be towed into position by transport units. Okay. We'll recruit some of these too. And here we have some new stuff. We have the 10.5 centimeter EFH-18. The most lethal weapons in the Great War were field and heavy artillery. Artillery can be used to bombard enemy units and positions, impede enemy passage, confine the enemy in a determined area, interdiction, or to respond to enemy artillery. Accurate observations are essential for precise and effective artillery firing. Although traditionally transported by horses, these cannons can now be hooked up to a towed by mechanized transport units. Hooked up to and towed by mechanized transport units. Okay. Then we have this one, the 15 centimeter SFH18, same text, the different gun. Get both of them too. Then we have this car, the SDKFC 222. Modern reconnaissance forces play an important role performed in the past by the cavalry. This role involves the exploitation of territory, detection of enemy units and positions, and acting as a rapid response unit. They are effective against infantry but vulnerable to tank attack and carry either machine guns or a small caliber cannon. Let's get one of them too. Then we have some trucks. Transport trucks. We have the Opel Blitz transport. Trucks and other transport vehicles contribute greatly to the motorization of the armed forces by transporting infantry units, artillery units and different types of cannon. They also transport mobile units and facilitate tactical maneuvers. Let's get one of them, and then the other one, what is that? The Opel Blitz supply, it's a supply truck. What was the other one? So this transport troops and the other one transport supplies. I believe we played with supplies. We could use this one too. The Great War highlighted the importance of supplies in modern warfare, even more so in mobile or armored warfare, with its necessity for fuel, ammunition and other resources. To attend to these needs, special units advance towards operating units, providing them with all they require and preventing them from becoming inoperative due to lack of supplies. Okay. No planes. We do have some ships, but Germany didn't have much of a fleet at the start of the war, so we won't use any planes. It will be enough to do this. Okay, so the arm here is a little stronger. Great starting army. We need Germany to be strong from the start so we can start the game immediately. We don't have time to wait on building up or something, especially since the game might not work forever. So we want the war to start immediately against all the neighbors that are using the same rebel units. I want them gone as soon as possible so we can start the wars against the other main factions. Of course I can't just invade all the neighbors at once, because then we will probably have a crash before we have finished off all of them. I did that previously and it crashed after 7 battles. On the 8th battle I believe it crashed out of maybe 11 battles. Let's see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, 8, 9, 10. So at least 10 battles, and I believe it crashed after the 7th. So, okay. So this area was Ostprussian, I see. East Prussia is the area. Then we have this area, East Prussian, West Prussia. Okay. We'll do the same thing here. Get the buildings that we have from the start. And then we will get some units. Same as in the other army. Baltic, so they have their flags, at least in this menu. We have the diplomatic diplomatic stance here, by the way. We can enter diplomacy by right-clicking on a territory held by another faction to enter diplomacy with them. Or we can click on the bag here. And we have all the minor factions here. Pretty much all the factions in the world, but they all have the same models and no unique units. It's sad. And their flags in battle are the same rebel flag, not the national flags like they have here. Okay, then we have the main factions, like for example Japan. But it's Hideki Tojo we are talking to, not the emperor. And Benito Mussolini of Italy. That's our allies. Then we have the United Kingdom under Winston Churchill. France under Charles de Gaulle. The Soviet Union under Joseph Stalin. And the United States under Franklin D. Roosevelt. We are playing Germany. List of diplomatic agreements. So we are at war with Britain and France currently, but not the United States, I think. We are in peace. Okay. So we're moving some agents to Poland too. Move all our agents there. We will attack, but we will not attack everywhere. We could move an army into Poland. That war should already be going on by now. Poland. Move this army there too. Alright. And in Schlesien. Schleswig or whatever. We will do the same with buildings first, starting buildings, and then the troops. Germany will be pretty strong at start, like they were in history, so it's not really cheating. Anyway, area of Poland too. We'll invade Poland. Well, this area is Slovakia. It's supposed to be an ally, I believe. They refused. There too. So we'll wait with that. Okay. This area now. other factions will get better stuff too. Didn't work with the buildings there. Now it did work. Oh, we can get some planes here. We have the ME-109 EML. Fighter planes perform the task of maintaining local or general aerial supremacy and have been under development since the Great War. They are powered by inline or radial piston engines and are in the main monoplane with the retractable undercarriage. Their considerable firepower, thanks to onboard machine guns or automatic cannons, can be used to prevent enemy planes reaching their targets. I will go for some planes too. We have the U-88 bomber. The improvements in multiple engine aircraft designs since the Great War has allowed the creation of large bombers with a great capacity for bomb storage. This allows many strategic targets to be taken out, such as factories and refineries, or tactical targets such as enemy units and positions to be attacked. According to the established theoretical principles on massive bombardment, level bombers could prove to be capable of deciding battles and wars. Alright, we'll go for it too. And then we have the U-52 Tantiu. Transport planes have a similar origin to level bombers, leading to several models carrying out both bombing and transport missions. Despite being essential for transporting and releasing paratroopers with precision, they are vulnerable to their low speed, due to their low speed and lack of defensive weaponry. Okay, yeah, we could use that too. But did I get any new troops? Infantry, I feel like I did. Yeah, we will remove those infantry units then. I clicked the wrong area. Okay. So we have a new army. We will attack Slovakia because they refused to be allied. Don't want to see that again. Can send some planes too. Send an agent there as well. Keep this army here. Okay, this area. Destruction. Don't want to attack anymore this time. We are attacking three areas and that's enough. It might crash if we attack too many areas, as I said. Okay, unit construction. Slavia here, but we don't want war with them yet. What is this? Hungary. Okay. Then we have this area. I believe this area was Österreich. Okay, Austria. This area was protectorate Böhmen and Mähren. This is Freistaat Bayern. Okay, let's go for the buildings here. The units. So we will be pretty strong in the beginning, but we still only have starting armies. Enough to take out the rebels pretty fast. Which is fine by me, because I don't like fighting rebels anyway. The same boring infantry and trucks. Okay, we have an army here now. Doesn't need to invade. They can defend. This area, Baden-Württemberg. Okay, unit construction. There's some more planes here. They can be constructed too. Okay, we're done there. So two armies here now. Send this agent into Schweiz or Switzerland. Yeah. They won't attack. We'll be defending. We have this area. Rhineland. Pfalz, Hessen. Okay. We will build buildings there too. Units, including the agent. Artillery, anti-tank artillery, reconnaissance car, troop transports, supply transports, some fighters and bombers. Okay, we're done there. This area, buildings, as usual, and then the troops, the infantry, the tanks, the anti-tanks, the artillery, the reconnaissance cars, the transports. We didn't have any ships here. Okay, we're down there too. This area was Nordrhein-Westfalen. We have this area, Niedersachsen. Okay, then the troops. Don't need any ships. Germany didn't have much of a fleet anyway in the start. At the start of the war, let's send an agent into Holland here, or the Netherlands, and one into Belgium here. Now we have an area here too. Schleswig-Holstein. Let's build the buildings there. Then the troops. The agent, the tanks, etc, etc. Alright, we're done. You won't attack there either, currently. Maybe disable on the turn after. Need to attack Belgium, Holland, and Denmark. Okay. Then we have this area. Anhalt, Sachsen, Thuringen. Here we want some buildings too. Some troops. One agent could be moved into Denmark. Then we have Berlin itself. Was it another area first? No, Berlin now. Okay, buildings. Building stat. I don't know. Medium vehicle. Okay. Yeah, we can build it then. Some infantry. Agent. Same tanks. Didn't get anything new there. Have some planes here too. Alright, we're done. The leader has a model too. You can see the stats, like he costs 140, maintenance cost 17, armor 150, speed 15, unit status potential 140, rank 0, life 100, same as the general, morale 100. So generals are single units in this game, but the leaders are not generals. They are supposed to be away from the battlefield. If they are ever captured, you lose the game, but they can probably be in battle. I have never seen a leader in battle, but they might be able to, just like the general. If, for example, he would be at this location and it's attacked and we have an army here, then the leader might be in battle. But I'm not sure. He has an model on the map at least. Okay. So now we are ready to click next turn. We can check the other options first. So here we have the statistics window, similar to Medieval 2. Only shows the main factions, but we need to wait at least one turn before we can see anything, I believe. And then we have Minister of War, Armies details, Infantry unit 26, Ships 6, total number of units 58. Vehicles 15, hero 0, global power of the army 21,076, maintenance cost of the army 2,397, aircraft 8, generals 1. Okay. Total number of buildings 37, maintenance cost of buildings 500. Okay. Alright, let's. What is this? List of territories, you can see all our territories here, and all our armies. So Hitler counts as an army. Okay. Yeah. Okay, then we have army details here. Air Force and the Navy, very small Navy. And this area, list of characters. We have Heinz Guderian, a general. It doesn't have a unique model, but it's a historical accurate name of a German general. Okay, so we have two generals. So the leaders are generals. Okay, and we are upgrading camouflage there. Okay, let's zoom out, click end turn. Let's zoom in maybe so you can see moves and movements. So the battle, I forgot to save the game. Fuck, if it's CTDs now, I will have to replay everything that I just did, and fuck, I did a mistake. I should have saved the game. I don't really trust other resolves, you know, because the game might actually, we might lose even though we have the upper hand. But on the other hand, if I play it in real time and it will CTD, then I will need to do everything I just did. So the enemy is Slovakia. They have 10,000 troops, 200 tanks. We have 1,000 tanks, 50,501 troops, 700 planes. We will fight this battle. I don't want to lose an army with planes. The best weapon against an enemy is another enemy. Friedrich Nietzsche. Battle tip. I couldn't read that in time. It could crash when the on that white screen. It won't crash, it will game lock and you have to exit. Alright, so the battle is about to start. Black and white intro. So I do not have any voices on because it's annoying to hear the voices. We have the enemy army here. It's just rebels, Slovakian rebels. Looking the same as every other rebel unit. They have some trucks, though. Transport trucks. And some infantry. Of course, on huge settings, it would be more interesting to watch. But even on large unit settings, the army is pretty big. See, there are still quite a few units in the army. And I don't think it's a full-sized army, but if it is, it's still pretty big. Especially if you think that about it, that there might be more than one enemy army in the battle and more than one allied army. So that's why we want to be large unit size. If it's huge, it could work one versus one, but in custom battle it still lagged when I zoomed in on the unit. Of course it looked better with more tanks and more infantry, but yeah, I kind of prefer to not have any lag. So we can place units inside of buildings and such. Infantry could be placed there. Okay, maybe not those buildings. Let's start the game. Fast forward, we are the ones attacking, so we will wait on the enemy to move to position. They will move as we have started the battle now. Zoom out like this, scroll around, good overview. We have these buttons, we can remove this, remove that one, and remove this one. So they decided to position themselves over here. The army use this formation. Too bad, sometimes the menu will bug out when I have already selected them and deselected them and I can't somehow click on it. Okay. And we can't use the formations in this battle. What is this? Supply point. We could use some supplies for the army. Take that supply point and slow down the speed. So we can zoom in on units like this. I didn't know about this. Well, I had seen a video of someone doing it already back in 2009, but I never figured out how to do it. But today I watched a video about how to do stuff, and they said if I clicked on Alt Ctrl L or whatever, then I clicked on the unit and I could zoom in on them like this. And it would lag if I had huge size on. It's pretty cool to see battles in this view. You can also use the scrolling button to move to different infantry. If you use it on a tank or a car, you need to select a vehicle instead of an infantry unit, then you can scroll between different units. But it won't zoom in as much on the tanks. That's why I prefer to do it with the infantry. Also, there are binoculars where you can watch troops like this and zoom in. Very cinematic, like if you were a general with a binocular. It's pretty cool too. Didn't know about that either. That's when you click on Alt Ctrl or Alt Gear and click on the map instead of on a unit. Also, the infantry, they can move into bunkers like this and take up positions. Defend, and the enemy can destroy these bunkers and destroy buildings too, that you can place troops in the buildings. But we are the ones attacking, so we need to attack. We have taken this supply point, so now we are getting new supplies to the army. We are playing with supplies and oil, I think. So I didn't play with raw materials on the map, but we are playing with supplies and oil. That's why we need points like that. All right. You can also send out fighters. We have our message mid 109 fighters here. Being sent in. By the way, the map, I have an option on that makes everything outside of the playable area white or removed. That's why it looks like a square. You can play with the setting on that enables you to see territory outside of the playable area, so it looks better, but it would also cause more lag. And not only that, but I am using low resolution to reduce lag in battle. So that's why the terrain isn't that beautiful from above. If we have maximum resolution on and maximum LOD on and maximum distance on, then it will look gorgeous even when you look at the area from the plains. It would look very good, but unfortunately it would be kinda laggy when you zoom in on units, which is what I want to do in some battles. I don't like when it lag. When I do that, I want it not to lag. We will send some bombers against the troops here and against the troops. Sending out some UAT bombers here. Tactical bombers like Stukas, or you can have the heavier bombers like the U-88. but and they can also shoot machine guns to defend themselves against enemy fighters. And then you have the fighter planes defending your bombers. And unlike the bombers, they don't just show up temporarily. They fight for quite some time, holding a dominant position in the sky. They're too high up for us to see them. Well, the bombers are lower, I believe, so you would be able to see them if you zoom out like that. Okay. Killed a few of the troops there. You only had the enemy had no fighters in this battle, so it didn't really matter much. We are resupplied. This supply point. We are attacking. Use this skill. Aggressive mode. Aggressive units will counterattack if attacked while moving. That's good. And trench. 2x defensive bonus against front fire. Stop. Retreat. Fall back to safe position. We have defense formation plus 5% armor plus 5% range. That's what we have now. The infantry is laying down. Harder to hit them when they do. Other units have this defensive structure in front of them. Okay, then there is the marching formation. The defense formation, we have the march formation, plus 5% speed, plus 5% range, and armor and range, firepower and range. Okay, we'll use the attack formation. It's time to attack those rebels on the other side of the bridge. Okay, we have ordered army to move. Click on. Okay, so the infantry is first. It's like watching it from this view. That's why it would be cool with the huge size. Unfortunately, it was laggy. Graphics would be even better if I had the distance on and the LP to max. Like these models, I think their pants are wrong. They should have this. They should stand out at the knee. I don't know why they don't do that. It's like they failed to do the pants correctly. But anyway, otherwise they looked okay. Graphics are good. Alright, battle statistics, Slovakia, casualties, They lost 341 out of 50,601 infantry units. They lost 10,000 out of 10,000 infantry. They didn't lose anything else. And they lost 200 transport vehicles too. Heroic victory. No crash after the first battle. Now it's Galician in Poland. So we have 10,700 infantry, they have 20,000 infantry. We have 1,600 tanks, they have 200 tanks. Okay, we will fight that battle too. Our own objectives are clear. The objective of smashing the militarism imposed by World War upon the enslaved peoples of the objective of liberating the subjugated nations. The objective of establishing and securing freedom of speech, freedom of religion. Alright. I started reading. It was too late. Good, it didn't crash. When we started this at least. Group the army, pretty huge army. So large size is still pretty good, especially when you have more than one army. But huge is even bigger, then it's like this size instead. And it would work pretty well, one versus one, if you are not zoomed in. But I like playing zoomed in. So. Alright, let's start. We didn't have any planes in this battle. We will fast forward so the enemy can move into position. Oh, they had some tanks, Poland. All tanks. And some infantry. Same infantry, but now they have tanks. We will use the... mode and then march formation, but we need to check if there are any areas we can take first. Maybe you want defensive formation. I changed my mind. You might want to take a supply area or something before attacking. Here we have supply point. Let's take it. Attacking the army. Looking pretty cool like this too. Oh, we have some trucks too. So when we use the binoculars, we automatically are transported with the camera to the ground. This ground view, general view, like if we were one of the generals. Alright, it's raining on this battlefield. So we're in Galician, in Poland. Maybe I will try to use the maximum graphics later. But the capitals, they will lag if I do. They will lag even on the low graphics, I believe. Maybe not low graphics, but when we have this, it will still lag. Might actually change it to maximum just to enjoy the gorgeous landscapes better, but it would be annoying if it started to like lag when we are in this view. So the legs move in slow motion and stuff. So we're taking the supply point here. There are some guys in the tanks too that are showing up every now and then. Now they lay down on the ground because they are in defensive formation. Or something, or artillery behind some mortars. Here we have the pioneer guy, another one. Mortar. Okay, so they will soon reach the point where they will sit down, place the mortar to the ground. Yeah, we might change the graphics to maximum, just to enjoy the mod better, the game better. It's an official game released in 2008. They kind of released it when it was unfinished. Never properly patched it. That's why it's so unstable. Here we have a machine gunner. Pretty cool. You lay down like that. We have some paramedics here. Yeah. We have some civil stuff here. Bike. Let's check the vehicles. So this is the car. Tank. Ah, these guys are still to reach their position. I don't like that the vehicles are more zoomed out than infantry. That's why it's cooler to view it from the point of view of infantry. It's pretty cool to view it like this too. Alright, I think they are supplied. Oh, the enemy is attacking. They're attacking. Moving up their tanks, despite us being the invader. Do they have their tanks? They are just named tanks, but they are clearly World War I tanks. Looking like Renault FTs or something. I think it's a Renault. Actually attack us. could actually ambush our artillery. The tanks. You can also zoom in on the enemy, by the way. The enemy infantry. By selecting them instead. And view the battle from their perspective. So that's pretty cool too. So the graphics doesn't look perfect because I'm not using maximum graphics here. Gonna do that when I restart the game. Try it at least. Alright, the army. Stop using that. Use the attack formation. We need to take out their tanks and other stuff. Their perspective. Polish rebels. these bombs tank. See here, we will select everyone again. And Citrull 1. Not really know where they are. Here they are. That was expected against the rebels. Rebels usually do not have any good stuff. So the game will only be fun when we start fighting the other main factions. The others will be just a cakewalk. So we can't change the graphical settings in the game. We need to go back to the menu to do that. So we won the Battle of Galician in Poland. Casualties, we lost 7,200. Infantry out of 10,700, they lost 20,000 out of 20,000. We also lost 270 of our vehicles, and they lost 200 out of 200 tanks. Okay, heroic victory. Now the final battle during this time against the area against Poland in KGR, Poland. So we have 72,100 troops, they have 20,000 troops. So we have the upper hand in infantry this time. And they have 200 tanks, we have 2,100 tanks. No planes and no ships. We'll fight in battle. Save before clicking end turn. They would also need to replay everything. So we can group individual units like infantry, artillery, etc. But against the rebels we'll just have one big group. It's fine by me. Now it was a larger force. You see the large force is still pretty large. So huge is even bigger. Shame they didn't add any modding tools to this. It could have been a cool mod to modify. people could have made it more stable. They could have added unique rosters to the other nations and unique flags and such, and could have made more factions playable, and could have added unique voices to everyone. And probably made it more stable too. Okay, let's see, if you look at the map, there are any areas where we can get something. Civilian buildings, we don't really need that. We can place troops there to defend if we are attacked, but we don't have any use for that now. But we could use supplies if there are any. Enemy has some tanks and infantry, just like in the previous battle. Ah, here we have some supply depot. Okay, let's move there. Battle, fast forward. So we got this from the start. We placed our army at the supply depot. We could do that. It wasn't outside, so we raised our banner there. Okay, so we have the supply depot and are supplying our army. It wasn't outside of the supply able of the deployable area. Okay. Place troops inside of the building. You can't look at it from their perspective when they are inside, but you can see that they have placed some troops there. The buildings can be destroyed, of course. We have no planes in this battle. All the troops are laying down. Problem, the main problem with this game is that it's usually unstable, and that's why I couldn't play it in 2018 when I wanted to, because it crashed immediately after every battle, or a few minutes after returning to the map. Now it doesn't, so finally I can play it again for the first time since probably 2013 or something, where I played it a little. Okay, it's time to march. Alright, attack formation and attack mode on. We will order them to attack the enemy here. And we don't need to have maximum speed on, we'll slow that down. So this is a bigger army. You can already see that it's glimmering, showing that it might actually be a bad idea to use huge settings. But we could probably increase the graphics. I don't think it will do much of a difference. Might be wrong too. So our vehicles are over there. Some are over there. Some engineers, pioneers in the back. Some are back in the camp still. Okay, so we won in KGR Poland. I believe that was the final battle during this turn. We lost 32,825 infantrymen. They lost all their 20,000. So we lost more infantry than they did. And then we lost 225 vehicles and they out of 800. And they lost 200 out of 200. Okay, we also lost 200. The cars. I mean, four of the cars. We had 100. Okay. It's a new turn. My leader, I advise you to press on the news events that fall on the right side of the screen at the beginning of each turn. They have notable information on our territories, troops, economic situation, new discoveries. Okay. Economic summary. Total expense 8,097. Total income 4,242. Not good. Okay. Conquest of territories. Your nation has conquered KTR, Poland. Your nation has conquered Galician in Poland. Poland, and we have conquered Slovakia that refused to be an ally like in history. Oh, here we have the Soviet Union. We have bordered them now. What area is that? The area. So we are at peace with the Soviet Union currently. We are only at war with France and Britain. 1939. So in peace with the US as well. I don't know the name of this area, but probably Ukraine. Okay. And here we have another Polish area. Probably the one that got taken by the Soviets in history. So here we can do something. We'll try that. We have taken the area in Poland that we held historically. The Soviet took the other area, so we will let them take this area, I think. However, could go and take Denmark. We'll move into Denmark next. Declaration of war. Well, and we could attack Belgium. That's the new three battles we need to fight. That's three battles. We'll conquer these three areas. Then it's just France remaining. We need to conquer before we can start war against the Soviets. But we also need Yugoslavia down here, and what is this? Hungary. They were allied. A vassal. Same with Romania. So in essence we could use all of these areas. This is Bulgaria, they were also a vassal. Albania was a vassal to the Italians. Greece was also conquered. So yeah, we will try to take the areas that we had before the war with the Soviet first, before we start the war with them. But France will have to fall. After we have taken these three areas, we will fight the war against France. Schweiz actually avoided the war, they were never invaded, so we can ignore Schweiz. Leave this area of Poland to the Soviets, and same with the Baltic states. Of course, this army could move down to Yugoslavia. This down into Hungary, but we won't do it now. So we have new upgrade ready, we will go for another one. So the construction, we'll go for new buildings. So here we have a heavy vehicle factory in Niedersachsen, or an aircraft factory. We'll go for the vehicle factory then. It will have to take its time to construct. Here we can go for a heavy vehicle factory too. And here a medium vehicle factory. I don't really care about money in this game. We'll just cheat to get it up, because it's very hard to not get bankrupt in this game. So money won't be an issue. We'll try to play with the oil too. But money won't be an issue on the map. It would ruin the campaign. But we could still lose the campaign if we are defeated militarily. Okay, so I guess we'll click next time. We will check this too. New technology discovered. Camouflage clothing. Okay. We will save the game now. Okay, save the game. I think we had some auto saves going on there. Okay, end the town. That's good that we have auto save function. Kind of wanted to get rid of the rebels in this town, at least the ones in Poland, Slovakia, and the ones in Denmark, Belgium, and Holland. Okay, so we're attacking Denmark. We have 10,600 infantry troops. Denmark has 10,000, we have 800 more. Then we have 1,300 tanks, and they have 200, and we have. They have actual. I believe we have a ship. Good. We can bombard them from the ships too. Let's fight this battle on the battle map. The best weapon I have, we have already read that. Alright, so the battle started. We will change the graphics only when we have restarted the game, so that will be on episode 2. This will all be episode 1, so it will be a pretty long episode. Here we have some cool new artillery pieces. 15cm SFH-18. And a 10.5cm EFH-18. Okay. Group them. Check if there are any supply areas where we can fill. Yeah, there are, but we can't place them there. Let's march there with the troops. They are winking at each other to follow too. It's pretty cool when it comes to such things. It's a game from the same year as, I believe it's 1 year earlier actually than Empire to the War. The graphics are very similar. Took this supply depot area. Oh, we are being fired at already. We took the supply depot. Enemies are far away. Nice. players in the same audience as the others. Seems they had some artillery. That's bad. We had trips down. Here are our trips. Guy and trips here. I'm not sure they are both the same. We bombarded them. If you click on this button, they will fire at the enemy. You can know where they are. Some paramedics. It's at a bunker. Okay. I'm bored of this battle. Let's group them. And group them again. Attack mode, attack formation. There are more troops over here. Some artillery pieces too. We are ready to invade. Move out of the supply depot area. All these battles against rebels will be used like showing off, I guess. Showing off battles. It's not really what I'm after in the game. It's not really what. I mean, it's no challenge taking care of the rebels. The real battle will be against other factions. victory. Right. So all the rebels are easy to win against, so no real victory challenge, I mean. It'll be interesting when we are fighting the other factions too, because they are strong. We are playing on very hard after all, on war leader difficulty. The hardest difficulty. Alright, so we took Denmark. We lost 5,378 infantry troops out of 10,600. The enemy lost 10,000 out of 10,000. We lost 53 out of 400 vehicles. And we lost 4 out of 300 trucks. Okay. The enemy lost 200 out of 200 artillery pieces as well. So, the Battle of Belgium, they only have 10,200 infantry. We have 10,600 infantry, so we have 600 more. No, 400 more infantry troops. Then we have 1,500 tanks and 200 planes. Okay. So we are totally superior here. Belgium will fall, no doubt. Okay. Then it's the Battle of Holland. Okay, let's group this. So we started exactly where we wanted to start. Just need a defensive position here. So we started in a supply area. Supply point, at a supply point. Capture this strategic building approaching your units, then conquered all of your units within its range. It'll be healed, repaired, reloaded one by one. Good. That's a good start. Let's fast forward because the enemy will move to position 2. They only had infantry this time. Oh, we had planes. We can move out the fighters then. Yeah, so Messerschmitt 109 fighters. They have no fighters. We don't really need them. But just to have the superiority in the air. Oh, they're moving all the way to our base. Let's go fast forward. Go all the way over here. Our guns are firing at them. Could be a problem when the enemy attacks. If they attack on too many places at once, it might actually crash before they won every battle or lost every battle. Okay. The army would be in attack formation and attack mode on. Get new supplies here. It's the perfect place to be in the actual battle. They move back their troops over here. So we just attack there. Stop, don't move. Change my mind. We'll use our bombers. They've opened these sides. Prepare size is pretty big anyway. I like it. Just wish we could use huge, then it looks even more underground. The terrain is damaged by the planes too, which is pretty cool. Alright, they stopped for some reason. The enemy has moved away. Don't exactly know where they are. Seems to be an enemy. So large scale is still large enough to give me the total war feeling. Anything smaller is too small. But huge would have been so great. Have we killed that guy and won the battle, heroic victory. Alright, we took Belgium. We lost 385 infantry, we lost 58 out of 600 tanks or vehicles, and they lost 10,200 out of 10,200 infantry. Heroic victory. Might be another battle, yeah, against Holland. So we have 10,600 men, they have 20,100 men, and then we have an additional 1,400 tanks. Let's fight this battle too and hope it won't crash. It's the final battle this time. War is merely the continuation of politics by other means. Karl von Clausewitz. Yeah, didn't hear at least. Alright, let's group the army to one. Group one there. As for supply depot area. Have any supplies nearby? There we have a supply area. We could place the army there, perfect. We just need defensive formation. Maybe to move them to that side. Alright, we're done. Start the battle, the game. Fast forward so the enemy can move. They always move in the beginning of the game. We had no planes in this battle, no ships. They only had the infantry. Troops are being supplied here. any artillery guns here. Yeah, we did. They might start to fire if the enemy gets closer. To have this mountain in the way. Might protect the enemy. Oh, they entered the city. They moved some troops into their buildings. Fire out of the windows. Garrison this building here. Some other buildings too. Okay. Let's put attack mode on, aggressive mode on, and attack formation. Oh, they have garrisoned the bunker too. We will attack the bunker. Will slow down the game. I don't like fast forward and attack. Don't really need the trucks to move there. But I forgot how to disable them. Attacking the bunker already. All my car over there. Over those fences. Firing. this medic is healing our soldier. Produce energy. Different the infantry that we're dragging. They are ours, I think. They are ours. Where is the enemy? They have troops in this building. There are enemies inside of the building. Absolutely true in war, where other things equal, that numbers, whether men, shells, bombs, etc. would be supreme. It is also absolutely true that other things are never equal and can never be equal. Okay. We lost 6,191 men out of 10,600. We lost 1 out of 400 vehicles. 77 out of 200 cars. And vehicles and tanks, and then Holland had 20,100 men. They lost all of them. A heroic victory. Battle is over. Battleships and cruisers can support terrestrial troops, making use of their naval artillery in those battles that take place in coastal adjacent territories. This support can be what is vital to succeed in certain battles. That we used some ships that way. Let's move these ships back. We can combine the entire fleet. We've taken Denmark, Belgium, and Holland. They're now pretty big. We still are lacking France and the areas in the Balkans. I believe France was next. Okay, so here are the economic report. Total expense 16,000. Okay, we just do this so we get some money. Don't care. Okay, and then conquest of territories. Your nation has conquered Holland, Belgium, and Denmark. Okay, your spy in Baltic Republics has been caught by trying to gather information. Okay, see that. Okay. So I need to build some stuff. We are constructing a building in Brandenburg already. Maybe not. We are. Okay. So in Freistadt Bayern we will go for another building. We will go for the medium vehicle factory. And in Rhineland Pfalz Hessen we'll get the heavy vehicle factory. In Anhalt-Sachsen, Thuringen, we will get the medium vehicle factory. Mecklenburg-Vorpommern. Could go for a port in Schleswig-Holstein. We'll go for the aircraft factory, or maybe we'll go for the heavy vehicle factory. In Denmark, we can go for a port. Network coastal guns, yeah, coastal guns. Can move that. Okay, we're done. Unit construction then. In Belgium, we can go for some infantry. Yeah. Holland too. West Prussian. Go for other stuff, but we don't really need more troops currently there. I want to have some troops in Denmark that we conquered. Ah, we couldn't. Maybe Poland. Kogar. KGR, Poland. Let's go for some buildings there then. Cannon factory. No, we'll go for troops. Barracks for regular troops. Same in Galicia. And in Slovakia. Okay, we're done. As for moving troops around. It's time to fight the French. We will save here. Wait a second, we will need to update this too. Okay. Save. And exit. So, this is the first episode. In the next episode, we will fight against France, but they have quite huge forces here. Maybe we can't win against all of these troops. Maybe we should back down. Hey. out for now. And see here, we want all of these armies to aid in the battle. And all the armies here. Planes can move two areas instead of one. We'll move the planes there then. We will save, so we will fight France, but we won't fight the next turn because France is too strong in the area of in this area. So we need to gather our troops and face this army, otherwise they will be too strong for us. Okay, we also need some defensive troops in case Britain sends reinforcements. End the turn. But I think we will end the episode. We will click end turn first, see what happens. How they moved some troops around, moved an agent into our area here, and moved some of their troops here. That's good that they divided them and do not have everything. One location, but they are still very strong here. They seem to have tanks, anti-aircraft, infantry and anti-aircraft vehicles, and then planes and more anti-aircraft vehicles. Okay, so report, economic summary. Okay, so we have very much infantry in Holland and Belgium. A network of coastal guns has been constructed in Denmark. We have new information of Baltic Republic. Okay. So you're spying on them. Okay. So this is the first episode. It became pretty long. Alright. Thanks for watching. See ya.